Hello all. Hopefully you can hear me. If there are any audio issues as we're going along, please take a moment and go ahead and type it in the chat box. We'll limit ourselves to the chat box for today just because very often trying to get audio working for everyone can sometimes be a little bit difficult. So we'll stick with the chat box, but I'll keep my eye over there. And as we're going along, as you're typing, I'll make sure to address any of the questions that you have. And I want this to be as interactive of a session as we can. This is really an opportunity for me to address the questions that you have. We're going to go through, and I'll talk about our agenda in a second, we're going to go through and kind of give some high points of what the research initiation grant process is, how it works, so what we expect, a few tips and tricks for having the best chance for being reviewed well and for potentially being funded. And we'll talk about those things, but also, as I said, there are going to be specific questions you may have, and I'd love to address those here today as well, because very often any question you have is going to apply to another number of other proposals as well. So let me start by introducing myself, and actually let me begin by apologizing in advance. I just came off of a week of being sick. There is a plague going around University Park campus right now, which I fell victim to last week. So if I cough a little bit throughout, I apologize, and I will try to lift up my my microphone as we're going along, not to blow out any eardrums. So me, I am Brad Zdenek. I am the Innovation Strategist for the Center for Online Innovation and Learning, and I have the honor of running the research initiation grant process for COIL. I have been involved since the beginning of the research initiation grant process, but really took it over the entire process over about 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago now, and have been working very hard to make this as open a process as possible, to be as transparent as we can be in everything related to it, and to also make it known throughout the university. The research initiation grant process is intended to be a source of seed funding for great ideas across university. Not across University Park, not for faculty, not just for students. This is intended to be a place to receive seed funding for the great ideas that Penn Staters have, whether they be faculty, staff, students, undergrad, graduate students, doesn't matter. If it's a great idea, you compete on a level playing ground with everyone else that is submitting for this process. And to make that fair for everyone, the least that we can do is to be transparent in all the criteria that we have, in the rubrics that we use, and in the format that we expect proposals to be submitted in. And we give you as many tools as we possibly can to help you along in that process. Today is not going to be me reading through all of those materials. You are more than capable of reading through those materials. But what I'm going to try to do today is to point out some of the salient points and some of the stumbling blocks that I have often seen for proposers throughout the RIG process. We are entering into our eighth cycle now. We have funded we've funded roughly $450,000 worth of grants every year for 3.5 years now. And so we have had a number of projects that have been active across Penn State, and we have had some great successes. Some you may have seen throughout news reports that we've had related to our research initiation grant process. Some you may know because they've become Penn State tools. If any of you have worked with the digital badging tool that is now here at Penn State, that really got its first catapult from the research initiation grant process. It started as a seed of an idea somewhere else. It ran out of funding there, needed a boost, ended up receiving one of our first rounds of grants, and has now moved to the TLT, who has taken on the project and has essentially released it as a Penn State tool that you can access at badges.psu.edu. So if you know anything about digital badges, micro-credentialing, that's one of our projects. And we have a number of others as well, all of which you can see, and sometimes this is helpful to be able to see projects that have been funded in the past. You can see all of them at our website, which is the place we're going to be spending most of our time today, is kind of going through the RFP that is live on our website, which is coil.psu.edu. Once you arrive at coil.psu.edu, you will see our normal menu structure here, as well as all of our events and news and things that are going on. But one of the tabs that you will see is grants. Under there, COIL Rig Index will show you all of the projects that we have funded through the past. And hopefully you're seeing all this on your screen. Again, if anything seems to not be working correctly, just let me know in the chat box. But this is a list of all the projects that we have funded, as well as contact information for the individuals that have worked on these projects. And this is the first tip or trick of the day, which we'll get into as we talk about the criteria, is if you're thinking about submitting, one of the first pieces of advice that I would give you is to go to this index and do a search for the topic area that you're working in, where your research is located, and see if there's been another project in that domain. We know all of our projects, and so if we see a submission, let's say we see a submission related to eye gaze with individuals with autism, for training eye gaze and interpersonal communications for individuals with autism, that's a project that we funded in the past. I would love to see a few of the names from that project on your project to show that you've done your research, you've done your homework, and you've found some linkages and collaborations that may help you. What it tells us is also that our projects that we have funded in the past are also being leveraged for new and exciting things. So here's a perfect example. When I gave the autism example here, you'll see using online learning technology to improve social skills for individuals with autism. If you click there, you'll see the research team that made up that research initiation grant. And again, when we're doing our review of these projects, when I see those names, I know that you've looked into these projects and look for any sort of synergies with things we already funded. So that is a great place to go, is to that Rig Index, which is under Grants, COIL Rig Index. But those are past projects that we've done. What we're going to be interested in primarily today is in the RFP, request for proposal that is live on our website. And it has just about every resource that you could possibly need for submitting, for putting together your proposal and for submitting your proposal. But before we get into the nitty-gritty, I want to give you the 1,000-yard view of how the rigs work and how the entire process works. So everything begins on May 13th, which is the due date for this round of research initiation grants. If you are thinking of submitting for this round, that by 5 p.m. on that date is when your proposal needs to be submitted. If you are not looking at submitting for this particular round, and maybe you're just looking ahead and you're thinking for the fall, we run the rigs twice a year, spring and fall. If you're thinking about the fall, this would be a great time, and just prior to that that May 13th date, would be a great time to volunteer as a rig reviewer. So we have a team of about 70 reviewers, 70 reviewers that come in. The number vacillates a little bit each round. But those 70 reviewers are assigned reviews, and they read through and go through the entire process of matching the criteria to the proposals and rating each one of the proposals on each one of those criteria, and then having broader discussions with the team, the COIL team, in order to decide on to make our funding decisions. So what being a reviewer allows you to do is kind of get a behind-the-scenes view of how the rigs are run, as well as getting a behind-the-scenes view of questions that our reviewers are coming up with and points that they push on and points that I push on during that review process to really ask the reviewers to critically think about certain elements of a project proposal. We'll talk about some of those today, but the experience of being a reviewer is second to none. So if you are not looking at being a proposer for the spring, I'd highly recommend volunteering to be a reviewer for the spring, and then you'll have that information to go into the fall. To volunteer as a reviewer, it's also under the grants menu, and you will see a volunteer as a rig reviewer option there. Quick and easy form. If you have time limitations and you wouldn't be able to spend the, we estimate about 2, maybe 3 hours of work. excuse me, 2 to 3 hours of work for the review process. If you can't do that, but you still want to volunteer, just send me an email, and we can work on that. In fact, I should have put my email in the chat box here, and I will do that now. There's my email. If you want to contact me at any point, you can send an email to baz122@psu.edu. So that's the rig review process. The whole thing works like this. May 13th, you send in your proposals, are due by 5 p.m. Eastern Time. We immediately, the next day, the next morning, we send those proposals out to our team of reviewers. Each reviewer is assigned between 4 and 5 proposals, all depending on how many submissions we get. I'm anticipating roughly 30 submissions for this round of research initiation grants. Historically, that's about what we've had for our spring. Those 30 submissions will go out to our 70 reviewers, and they will have until June 3rd to complete their reviews. So relatively quick turnaround time. They have a little under 2 weeks, or a little over 2 weeks, I think a day over 2 weeks, to review the proposals. They are given a full rubric that we will walk through in a little bit, and they are also given a training by me to help them understand how to review a proposal and what we're really looking for, and to point out the high points of what we're looking for in a proposal and how to read the rubric. So that's June 3rd. Reviews are done. By June 8th, we have our decision made. And what that means is we take all of the scores from the reviewers, 70 reviewers. We do a full statistical analysis of them. I eliminate scores that are 2 standard deviations from the mean, so outlying scores. We also look, I read through every single review, every single score, and look for any great discrepancies, looking for large standard deviations within any of the reviews. And we take all that information to our directors table, where the COIL directors, of which there are 5 five directors and myself, we sit down and we look at those scores and we use those to inform our decision. Please note that I did not say that we go hand in hand with what those scores are. Very often we do. In fact, almost always we do. But we do allow ourselves to disagree or deviate from what those scores are in certain situations. And this particularly comes down to the innovation question, which we'll get to in a few minutes. Innovation is a hard thing to handle. It's a hard thing to define. And unfortunately, very often we hear the, we know innovation when we see it. But what we've tried to do is we've tried to give a very specific definition for what innovation is. And sometimes our reviewers don't share that definition of innovation, and sometimes we have to deviate from what their scores are based on that. We'll talk about that in a minute. But the directors and I sit down, we go over all the scores, we go over all the proposals, and we use those scores from the reviewers to make our decision. We award up to $40,000 per proposal, all depending on what the amount requested is from our top, let's say, 5 or 6 proposals. Depending on what those asks are, we are anticipating that we will fund between 3 and 5 proposals this round. So I said we will have 30 submissions. We're looking at funding 3 to 5 proposals. If they come in significantly low, our average so far has been about $38,000 out of that 40. So if it is in with history and 38,000, we'll most likely only fund 3, maybe 4. Once we have that decision on June 8th, then we will announce on June 8th with a press release and emails to everyone, whether you have been awarded the grant or not. And on July 1st, your money is in hand for the beginning of the grant. So you will see it is a very, very quick process there. Submission date is May 13th, and money is in hand July 1st. Decision is in your hand within a month, May 13th. Decision is in your hand on June 8th, so you can begin your planning process. The speed of the review process is intentional. We don't want to be a barrier to you doing your innovative work. So we want to do everything we can to cut through whatever red tape we can to get money in hand so that you can start doing whatever you want to do. Whatever is in your proposal, what you've submitted, and what we've said is a fantastic idea. We don't want to stand in the middle of that. And that is a theme that you'll see even while during the running of the program. If you end up being funded, we will have another one of these meetings, which will be one-on-one, face-to-face, and we'll talk about COIL's role throughout the life of your grant. And we really try as best we can to be facilitators and not impediments to the research that you're doing. So that's kind of the broad view of things. Submission, review, decision, money, all within about a month and a half, 2 months. What we have to do first is we have to get through the actual proposal process and look at what a great proposal is, what will give you the best chance of being funded. And where you'll find that is on the COIL site. Again, coil.psu.edu, under grants, you will see a menu item that says call for rig proposals. When you click there, you will come to coil.psu.edu/rigs. And this is the RFP, this is the rubric, and this is also the checklist of components for the proposal all in one. And there are also worksheets that you can download throughout this page that I'll point out today. One of the first questions that always comes up is who can have these grants and what can they be used for? So I've already told you that the RIGs are intended to be seed funding to enhance teaching and learning here at Penn State using innovative techniques or pedagogies or approaches or research or development projects. So that's what the grant is. Who it's for is anyone affiliated with Penn State as the PI. So what that means is we actually give, in the criteria you'll see, we actually give additional credit or scores for collaborative teams that include individuals from outside of Penn State, other universities, other individuals, whoever would be best to have on a team to meet the goals that you state within your proposal. The PI, the person who is going to be managing the money, the person who is going to be in charge of the project, the PI has to be a Penn State affiliated individual. That means that they must be faculty, staff, or currently enrolled student, grad student or undergrad, doesn't matter. As long as that individual is affiliated with Penn State, then they can serve as the principal investigator. If, and this has happened in the past, if it's an individual that may be leaving Penn State during the course of the research initiation grant, that is okay as long as there is a secondary individual on the team that can have the PI status transferred to them during that time. RIGs run for 18 months. The project itself must have a 12-month timeline, but the money is actually available for 18 months, and that's because there's a little bit of startup time. Not everybody's going to be ready to hit the ground running on July 1st. Sometimes there's a little bit of money that needs to be buttoned up at the very end of the proposal or at the very end of the grant process, particularly with conferences and travel and dissemination needs. So we have the money available for 18 months, but the project is actually for 12. So hopefully the individual that is PI will be here for the duration of the project, but that's not always a guarantee. So in those cases, we simply ask that you have someone that you can transfer PI status to, and then you can also stay on that project even after you leave Penn State as part of the broader team. So that's the eligibility, anybody who is affiliated with Penn State. What can the money be used for? There's a whole list here that you will see under funding, use of funds, but a few things that I will point out. One of them is that the primary use of RIG funding to date has been for personnel, for people, for time. So this has primarily come in the form of graduate assistance. Graduate assistance cost roughly $33,000 to $36,000. So it's right in that sweet spot for what the maximum funding is allowable for these projects. But it is also for staff time. It can be for faculty buyout time. And this is particularly important for individuals from Commonwealth campuses who may not have a number of graduate students or graduate students available to them for graduate assistantships. But the money can also be used for staffing. So if you are going to buy out a staff member's time, that's fine. If you're going to buy out faculty time, that is also fine. Although we discourage, and please note that I didn't say we do not allow, we discourage the removal of faculty from normal teaching duties, particularly during the fall and spring semesters. What we don't want is we don't want these grants to take good teachers out of the classroom. You know, we are a university, we're teaching students, and if we can do this research work during the summer, say if you're a 10-month contract employee and you want to do work during the summer, that's great. But what we don't want to do is buy you out of a course and take you out of the classroom and take you away from that student contact time. A case can be made for it, and I think we spell that out a little bit here in this last bullet. A case can be made for it, but it is something that you would have to explicitly address within your proposal if you're planning on that. Otherwise, summertime, again, 2 months if you've got a 10-month contract, those types of situations are perfectly fine. It also needs to be made a case for being pulled out of the classroom because most faculty here at the university have relatively robust research time built into their contracts. So they have some research time that they could be applying to these types of projects. If you are a student, if you are a graduate student or undergraduate student, or particularly if you're a graduate student and you want to create your own graduate assistantship, you can do that and pay yourself through this project. What you need there is you need to work with your department that you're in to get their approval because every graduate assistant needs what's called a slot here at the university. And there are only a certain number of slots that are available. COIL will not be providing you with a graduate assistant slot. What we will provide you with is the money for your stipend for the project as well as for tuition. So tuition and stipend will be covered, but we will not provide you with a slot. You'll need to get that from your department, which typically is not much of an issue, but you need to work with your department in advance for doing that. You can use the money for travel. You can use the money for your own travel, or if you're working in a collaborative team for bringing people here to Penn State to work with you. You can use it for equipment, although we do discourage the use of money for regular laptops and equipment that would normally be available to you as a staff or faculty member here at Penn State. There are exceptions to that. You need a specialized server. You need a specialized type of laptop. Perfectly fine. Again, these are things you need to make a case for because one of the criteria we'll get to in a few minutes is asking whether the money is going to good use. And as a reviewer, if I see that most of your money is being used to buy laptops for staff members that are on this project, my first question is, don't they already have laptops? Don't they already have a computer issued by Penn State? So you'd want to make that case in your proposal to overcome that argument before it's even made. And that's really the trick to writing a successful proposal for this grant program, is anticipating the questions that reviewers are going to come up with and addressing them before they can voice those questions. And I'll try to point out some of those questions that come up very often as we go through today. That's one of them, is what are you spending the money on, and don't they already have this? Laptops are a common topic of conversation when we're reading through proposals and reviews. So again, not that you cannot use the money for laptops, but if you are, explain why the individuals don't already have them or why those laptops or pieces of equipment may be different and explain it for a non-specialist. Wages, you can use the money also for purchasing consultation time, for instance, from any statistician or statistician group here at Penn State. If you need some help with data analysis, buying some time from individuals or developers, say at the TLT, those are all examples of places that you can spend the money. Because this is Penn State money for Penn State people, because this is Penn State money for Penn State people, essentially all that you have to do is add in fringe. Luckily, you're not going to be hit too hard as you would be on other grants for some of the additional monies that are tacked on to grant funds that come in. What goes along with it, and we'll get to this a little bit later, but I'll mention a few times throughout, when doing your budget, we require the use of the Penn State SIMS tool. If you don't immediately know what the SIMS tool is and you're thinking of proposing, reach out to your finance office now to gain access to the SIMS tool. The SIMS tool is a standardized tool that we use across Penn State, particularly for grants, that is a standardized way of creating budgets and it has all of the fringe rates, it has all the salary and stipend information for graduate assistants of different levels. It has all that hard-coded into the system. So when you create a budget, all those numbers we know are correct. And that's the reason we require the use of the SIMS tool. You do not automatically have access to the SIMS tool just by your affiliation with Penn State. So please, if you do not already have access, you have not already used it, make a note right now to reach out to your finance office or your financial representative or officer to work with them. Sometimes they'll just grant you access and let you use it. Sometimes some departments are a little more locked down and they'll want you to sit down and have a consultation with them for putting the budget together. That is completely up to each individual department and finance office. We have very little say in that. So please make a note to do that right now. If you submit a proposal and it does not have a SIMS budget in it, I will send it back to you. That night of the 13th, when I receive all the proposals at 5 p.m., by 6 p.m., I've gone through all of those proposals and I've looked at the formatting for them and what's been included. And if I see you did not use the SIMS tool, which is very apparent, if I see you didn't use it, I will send it back to you and give you 24 hours to correct that. Otherwise, the proposal will not be submitted to reviewers for review. So it's something we're relatively serious about. And this was a situation in which we learned our lesson the hard way, had a proposal, ended up being funded. Fringe and some of those elements were completely mishandled in the budget and ended up being a situation in which we had to find additional money for a proposal that had already been funded. Fool me once, and so we're using the SIMS tool from now on, and that's a requirement for all submissions. Funding priorities. This is just a place where we have kind of pointed out some of the things that are already apparent throughout the criteria that we use for review, but we want to kind of pull them out and let you know how important it is. Really, if I were to say there are three primary parts of the proposal, these are them. Number one, that the proposal can make the case that it is an innovative idea. And we'll get to what innovative means in just a minute. That it's innovative. Second, that it is an idea or a project that has a potential to impact learning. So innovative, can impact learning. And third, that it aligns with COIL's current themes of It aligns with COIL's current themes of personalization and access, student retention. I'm sorry. With COIL's current themes of personalization and student retention. Those are three things that are primary parts of the proposal process, and you'll see them in a few minutes when I go into the actual structure of the proposal. They are separate sections, and they are the three places where you will make or lose your most points on your proposal. They are three sections that are worth 10 points each, which is relatively significant in the review process. And it's a place where, because there is such tight competition for the proposals, losing two or three points in any of those sections can essentially remove you from contention for funding. So those are three things that you really need to laser focus on. And this is where I'll offer something that I'll offer a few times throughout our talk today, is that I offer consultations for any proposal. And I'm usually taken up, out of those 30 proposals, usually I will have met privately with a dozen up to 15 of the proposers prior to the proposal due date. And what I do is I will sit down with you, I will read your proposal in advance, and I will give you comments and some insights as to how I feel you may be able to improve your proposal. I will give you some insights as to where I think reviewers may have problems or questions, and I will do my best to give you a leg up in the review process, or at least to allow you to create the best proposal you can for the project you're interested in pursuing. So when it comes to those three elements, the innovation, the alignment with COIL themes and the impact on learning. Those are three things I really focus on during those consultations is, have you made the case to me on these three elements? And I will push you on those, and we can talk about those. And I'll read additional drafts of your proposal to see if that case is being made a little bit better. The reason I can do that is because I am in this process to remove myself from having any conflicts of interest. I remove myself from the decision-making process. What I act as is I act as chief advocate for every proposal. So when I sit down at the director's table and the directors are discussing a proposal, I make certain that I am well aware of what your proposal states, and I try to represent your proposal to them in those discussions. And the same is the case with the reviewers. During the review process, you will also have a chief advocate amongst the reviewers. That will be the individual that will essentially present your proposal to all the reviewers during our large review meeting, and that individual will, again, represent your proposal. I do the same thing at the director's table and remove myself from the decision-making process of saying this will be funded or this will not, because an individual has to be there for it because you can't be there. So also having those consultations gives me a better view of what your proposal is and the project that you are looking at completing. And it gives me a bit of an insight into what you're doing as well, and it allows me to better advocate for you. So funding priorities, we have a few other things in here. I see alignment with themes, enhancing learning, and so this is where we say that you can have some additional points for having collaborative teams. And this is, the reason we pointed out in this funding priority section is because it's not explicit within the criteria we'll get to in a few minutes, but it can be easily inferred in a few different sections. Particularly one criterion that is asking, is this team well prepared to conduct the project or development that they are proposing? And one of the best ways of making that case is to show that you have found the individuals that are best able to contribute to the success of your proposal. And those individuals may not be the people in the next office down the hall from you. They may be individuals across the state. They may be individuals at other campuses. They may be individuals across the world. And so when we see those teams and we see individuals on the teams from other campuses, from other colleges, from other universities, from independent companies, from nonprofit organizations, it lets us know that you are trying to get the best people to the table to complete your project. So that's why we pointed out in this funding priorities section is just to make it a little bit more explicit, even more so than it is within the criteria. Funding guidelines, I already told you, $40,000, which is a maximum ask for these grants. You can have, this is a question that comes up often, multi-year proposals. It's hard to do research, complete research in 18 months, particularly with a 12-month timeline, 18 months of funding. So very often, these projects are intended to be multiple year projects, but they're being submitted as 1 year projects for the grants. That is fine. We do not fund multiple year projects. What we do is we will fund 1 year of a project. If you need to tell us about what would happen after that project to give us context within the proposal, that's great. But we are basing our funding decision on what would happen within that 1 year. If things go well, and you want to submit for subsequent years of funding, that is perfectly fine, but what you will do is you will then compete on a level playing field with all the other proposals for that subsequent year. This is intended to be seed funding, so we're really looking at quick and dirty development, research, and not looking at getting ourselves into 2, 3, 4 year projects. There are other funding opportunities and funding sources for those types of projects. It's a little bit different than what the rigs are intended to be. However, we do recognize that sometimes there are great ideas and they can be segmented into two separate years. We'll fund the first year. If you show success in that first year, you submit for the second year, you obviously have an excellent chance of being funded for that second year if you can prove that you've met your goals, your milestones that you put within your first year proposal. That has only happened, it's actually only happened once. We have funded a number of tangential projects, which is a completely different matter. And that's where you complete your rig and you're getting toward the end of it and you have uncovered a new idea or a different idea or a derivative idea, tangentially related idea that you are also interested in pursuing. And then you can submit that for another grant. I'll give you an example here. We funded an individual by the name of Conrad Tucker in the College of Engineering here at Penn State. He was developing a virtual classroom where you can do virtual labs in a virtual space using Oculus Rift glasses, interacting in this virtual space with various tools. So one of the things you could do is build a fan. You could take the motor and put a blade on and switches and plug it in, and you could do all these really neat things in this demonstration. During that, he discovered that what would be very useful is some sort of glove where it could monitor what your hand is doing and it better interact with that virtual space. So he submitted another proposal for development of a haptic feedback glove for use in these types of virtual environments. And it's another grant that he received, and it allows you to go into these virtual spaces and interact with those elements using biofeedback from your actual hand. Really neat idea, closely related to his first project, but it was a tangent from that project. So those types of things are not a question, but again, they have to be submitted and they will compete on equal grounds with all the other submissions for that new round. I already let you know that you will know within a month whether or not you have been funded. And everyone, whether you're funded or not, will receive an enormous amount, usually about 10 pages, of comments and feedback from our reviewers. I have been told again and again that feedback is enormously beneficial in fine-tuning and improving proposals. What we will also be doing this year, which is different than something we've done in the past, is we will also be providing you with a bit of feedback whether or not we feel it would be beneficial for you to submit in subsequent funding cycles or not. To essentially let you know, look, this is a great project, but it just doesn't fit in with the rig priorities. Or to tell you, this is a great project, you are really close, please revise and resubmit. And you know, letting you know you have a good chance of being funded this next time around. So we're still working out the wording on that and how that will work, but you also get that information this time as opposed to past cycles where it has simply been you were not funded or you were funded. So the proposal. Oh, and again, let me remind you, if you have any questions as we're going along, feel free to type them in. I've seen a couple people start and stop over there, but if you have questions, let me know. So the proposal itself, I've got it all broken down in here under proposal, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to skip us to the end of this and show you this link right here, which says click here to download a rig proposal checklist. This is one of those worksheets that you can use, and if you click on that, it will open up this PDF that you can download. You'll notice nice little checkboxes. I like checkboxes. I like lists. So this is intended for you to be your pre-flight checklist before submitting your proposal. To go through here, check on these things, and make certain that you've included them. This is basically what the proposal should look like. First, you have a cover page. It's roughly one page. It has all of this information on it. Again, you can read this to know what to put in there. There's nothing really that's unusual here. Abstract. Same as you would for most scholarly publications, you're going to have a 200-word abstract that gives us the sense of what your project is. Excuse me. And you know, it is really an addition to the meat of the proposal. Innovation. This is where we get into the meat of the proposal. So you will have a 200-word section. 200 words. That's very short. A 200-word section in which you will tell us what is the innovation here. This is your first chance. This is your first opportunity. This is your first impression to the reviewers and to the COIL staff. Letting us know, why should we think that this is innovative? Why is this considered innovative? Now, to get into that, I have to go back one step and bring us to something we'll go through in a little bit more detail in a second. What is innovation? And what does COIL consider innovation? We have within our criteria a definition of innovation. And this definition really comes down to this. I'm going to read this because we've been working very hard on narrowing down this definition as to be as explicit as we can, while also not being too terribly limiting. Because we're dealing in an innovation space right here. We do not want to eliminate ideas and proposals simply by trying to come up with a strict definition. So here's what we have come up with. And this has worked very well for us for the last few rounds. COIL defines innovation as research, development, or introduction of something new or novel, be it an idea, a device, or an approach, with the intent of improving learning. Now, what we ask, what we tell the proposers, what we tell the reviewers to ask themselves are these questions. Is this new or novel? So is this something that is old hat? Is this something that we have seen before again and again? Or is this a relatively new thing? Does the proposal represent an innovation that is not a refinement to an existing process, technology, or approach? So this basically means is when we're talking innovation, we're not talking about taking something that has been used for a long time, let's say video conferencing technology. We're not talking about making that a little bit better. How do you make that video conferencing high definition? How do you make that video conferencing more effective? Unless you're coming up with a completely new type of video conferencing technology that I can't think of at the moment, that is not innovative. Along those same lines is that this thing that you're putting in your proposal is not applying an existing approach to a new context. So an example that I've heard in the past has to do with nursing. So in nursing, video conferencing for just-in-time mentoring is actually somewhat challenging due to privacy concerns related to the patients and students and the like. Just-in-time mentoring using video conferencing has not been as prevalent within the nursing field as in broader education. To my understanding, I'm not in nursing, I am in education. Education, we've been working on this for a long time. So we have had a proposal in the past in which there was the idea to implement a video conferencing technology in the nursing field. And the case for innovation was that in nursing, this hasn't been done. And they were going to take the lessons learned in education and in some other fields, particularly engineering, and apply them to nursing. That is a great idea. I'm sure that it would impact learning. By COIL's definition, that is not an innovation. That is an application of an existing approach to a new context. And so those are really the three questions you have to ask yourself as well. Is this thing that I'm proposing new or novel? Is this thing not a refinement? Is this thing something, again, new or novel? And is the thing I'm presenting, is this really just applying something we've already done to a new context? So those are the three questions you really have to ask yourself when proposing here to determine whether or not this thing is innovative. And the first place you have in the proposal to make that case, to answer those three questions, which is really what you should be doing, is answering those three questions for the reviewer, is in this innovation section. You can expound upon this within the narrative, but this is your first chance to make a first impression on your innovation. And so I would highly recommend that if there is one section in your proposal you spend the most time on, this is it, that innovation. Next, you're going to have an impact on learning statement, same type of idea. Letting us know how will your proposal impact learning. 200 words again. And then third, how does it align with COIL's research priorities of personalization and student retention? Then you get a 5-page narrative to go into detail on all that, and you'll notice a checklist of things that you should be thinking about or addressing in that section. And again, I'm not going to read this to you, give you the opportunity to go through this and use it if you'd like. After the narrative, which is 5 pages, you have a section for references, 1 page maximum, a section for team bios, which does not have a page limit, but I would highly encourage you to make it something short enough that it's palatable for reviewers. Do not expect reviewers to read a 50 pages of bios, particularly if you have a larger team. Try to make them as succinct and as on point as possible related to this project. Let us know why your team can do this thing that you're proposing. Not that they've had a number of publications in another field that's unrelated. So team bios. Estimated budget, you will notice again, created using the PSU SIMS tool. And in that, there will also be a budget narrative where you go through and explain what each one of those items in the budget, what they are and why they're there. Again, you will notice estimated budget does not have a page limit, but keep it as short as you can. A dissemination plan, not to exceed 1 page. That's just letting us know how are you going to let other people know about this project. Bonus points for thinking about the use of possibly COIL conversations or COIL Fisher talks in your dissemination plan. Those are always nice things to see. That's pro tip number 2 for the day. So that's something that you can put inside your dissemination plan, as well as your typical conferences, journal submissions, and the like. And any sort of supporting material. This, again, be smart about using your supporting material. You could put in 5 pages of supporting material and have a huge impact because the reviewers will read through that with a fine-tooth comb. Or you could put in 60 pages of additional material and it could be for no benefit whatsoever because no one's going to read it. Reviewers are not required to read the supporting material with the same thoroughness that they are required to read the rest of the proposal. The supporting material is basically there to help them help answer questions that may come up in the narrative, or to provide very often screenshots or demo shots of a tool that you're talking about building. That is the checklist. I highly recommend that you use that prior to submitting, or even better, have a colleague go through your proposal and check off those boxes. You all know, I know well, when you're doing proposals like this, you often get lost in them once you've looked at them enough times. A fresh pair of eyes can always be beneficial. Along those lines is this criteria for project selection. Here are the exact criteria that we submit to reviewers and that I train reviewers on for your proposal. Each one of these elements, and there are 10 different criteria, each one of these will be handed to the reviewers in a rubric, which I'll show you in a second, and which you can download in a rubric, and they will use that rubric for assigning point values to your proposal. You will see the point values in the sections right after what the criteria is. So you will see innovation, 10 points, enhancing learning, 10 points, and we give some guiding statements here to help you think through what we mean in each one of these criteria. Alignment with our themes, 10 points. I mentioned those are 3 very important sections that if you don't do well on, you can hurt your chances of doing well in the overall review. R&D team is well prepared to execute the project, 5 points. Applicability, which means that can this idea be used beyond this particular use case or possibly beyond Penn State? So what we don't want is we don't want to spend $40,000 on an idea that is going to work during one of your sessions of one of your courses and really have no broader applications. So this applicability is looking, does it have broader applications? Cost effectiveness, are you spending the money well? This is Penn State money, so this is public money. This is coming from our students, tuition. We want to make certain that this money is being used well. We're stewards of this money, the onus is on us to make certain of that. So cost effectiveness, 7 points. Feasibility, can you do it? Can you do it in the time that you say you can do it? Can you do it with the budget you asked for? 5 points for feasibility. Do you have a research evaluation plan? 10 points. Potential to generate subsequent research and funding. This is something that you'd want to include in your narrative. Are there other grant programs that you'd be submitting to after this? This is seed funding. We're not expecting you to have a finished, polished project at the end of this. So what's your plan? Once this $40,000 is gone, what's your plan? We're not going to hold you to it, but we want to know that you're thinking about it and that you've looked for some sources of money outside of Penn State. Again, this is seed funding. We're looking at ways of bringing some external grant money into the university by providing the stepping stool for these projects. And finally, the dissemination plan, 3 points. How are you going to let other people know about this? You will notice immediately after that, there is a link to the scoring rubric. Here it is. This is the rubric. You can go through this rubric and you can review your own proposal. Or, even better idea, as I mentioned before, give this to a colleague or a few colleagues and have them score your proposal. And go through and use this rubric. And it's a standard rubric with the criteria listed here and some guiding thoughts for point values here. And here's a multiplier. So you'll notice the innovation is worth a maximum of 10 points. Can get up to 5 here. Multiplier 2 brings you to 10 points. So this is the rubric. And it's all laid out for you, and you can download it. It is the exact same rubric that we will be using for our reviewers. One of the last things that we do is we provide you with a few examples of highly rated proposals from the past. These are redacted versions, so things such as budgets are blanked out. Some of the information that PIs did not want to share blanked out. And I will also point out that these are submissions from past rounds, which means there were different criteria. There were possibly different sections within the proposal. This has been a grant process that has developed and matured over the years. So do not take these two examples as perfect versions of formatting and content. Use them as good examples of how to make the case of what you're going want to do, how to make your case for innovation in particular. So these are two things that you can download and read through them and glean what you can from them. There are a few things about expectations. If you are awarded the grant, what we'd expect you to do, pretty basic, really easy. If you've ever been part of most other grant processes, that we don't ask for much, but it's listed in here. As I mentioned, if you are not submitting this round, please submit to be a reviewer. You will not regret it. You do not have to be here. You do not have to be able to attend the in-person meeting. We do virtual meetings. If you cannot do all of the reviews, then you can contact me directly at the email I put in the chat box. You can contact me directly, and I will set you up for one review, two reviews, whatever will work for you. I want to give you that opportunity to see how the process works. That said, if you are submitting this round, or if you are on a team that is submitting this round, that is an obvious conflict of interest and you would not be allowed to review for this round. We eliminate reviewers that have clear conflicts of interest with submissions, and so we go through all that when we assign reviewers to projects. So you can just save that time, and if you are proposing, just go ahead and don't volunteer. And save it perhaps for one of the next rounds, which, if you're funded, that's one of the expectations, is that you will serve as a reviewer for a future round. Here at the very bottom section, information sessions, you will find links currently to last year's or last cycle's trainings and overviews. These will be updated once we're done here today. We will post-produce this video and we will upload this, so if you want to look back through it for any reasons, or share it with any team members, it will be there for you to share. There will be a link to it. So that's the broad overview of the research initiation grant process. A few salient points I would point out. Number one, focus on innovation and focus on your argument for innovation. That is what makes or breaks most proposals. So focus on that innovation statement. Second, do not hesitate for a moment to reach out to me for any of the sit-down sessions that I'll do. I am going to be out on a bit of a conference tour for the next few weeks, but I'll be back after that. I'll be gone next week. I'll be back the week after, and I have kept my schedule purposefully clear so that I can come out and help or have a Connect session like this and we can talk, or just send me a link to your Google Doc or whatever of your proposal. I will read it, comment on it, send it back to you, and provide any sort of insights that I possibly can. I have done that for a number of proposals, and very often it has helped those individuals to refine their proposals to the best that they will be, and a number of them have been funded. So I'd highly recommend that. If not myself, there are a few other members on the COIL team that are good to sit down with. One of them, if you know, Bart Purcell, who is with TLT. He does a fair amount of work with the rigs and a fair amount of consultation because he's representing TLT resources, which are often brought to the table. So he's a good individual to reach out to. Kyle Peck is a good individual in the College of Education, a good individual to reach out to if you're interested in sitting down and talking with him. But any of us, if you reach out, it will be better than not reaching out at all. Often I make the case that proposals are funded, not necessarily just the idea. You can have a fantastic idea, but if it is not proposed the right way for that grant process, it has a lower likelihood of being funded. On the other hand, if you have a great idea and it's well proposed, it's well described, and it's well explained within the proposal itself that's submitted, you have an excellent chance of being funded. So those are the things that I can help with, is helping to refine that proposal piece, as well as helping you think through the innovation piece and helping you think through your project. I've been lucky enough to be a member on a number of different projects, so hopefully I can bring some insights to the table on your design as well. And I'm more than glad to do that. So with that, any questions currently out there that I can address? By no means do you have to put them all out right now or put it into the chat section. You can feel free to email me or call me after the fact. Okay, for the timeline. The timeline for this round would be that money would be in hand July 1st, 2016, and all money would need to be spent by December 31st, 2017. So that means that your project would have to essentially run for a one-year time period. So if you submit and you say, I'm not going to begin July 1st, I'm going to begin August 1st, just to throw a date out there. Your timeline should run for a year from August 1st, 2016 to August 1st, 2017. Your money is still available until December, but what we want to know is, what is your project timeline over that 12 months? Your money is still available after that, particularly for dissemination. So your project might be over August 1st, 2017, but then you're going to go to a conference in September, another one in October. That's all perfectly fine. You have 18 months to spend the money. But what we want to know is, your project is done within about a 12-month time period. Hopefully that answers that question. Erica. Oh, thank you. Hopefully it has been helpful, and particularly for those of you at campuses, if you want to talk at all, particularly with being helped with linkages to support units here at the broader university, I'm more than glad to help with that. TLT in particular is a great resource to bring to the table and can often take a $40,000 project and make it go much, much further by bringing additional capacity to the table that they do not charge you for, if your project is within their strategic goals or meets up with their strategic goals or is in alignment with their strategic goals. So those are contacts and people that I can definitely help you with, which is another reason why those consultations are very beneficial, is sometimes you throw an idea out to me and I can say, you know what, we had someone submit for that last round, or you know what, I've been working with so-and-so at TLT and they'd be very interested in that project. And sometimes I can help to find synergies with other groups. And that, again, can also help bolster your proposal, because it's showing that you have a broad, well-developed collaborative team that can do the work that you're saying you want to do. So I will mark time for another couple seconds here while other questions are coming in. But I will tell you that the recording for this session will be up within the next 2 days. So you'll be able to find it at that coil.psu.edu/rigs section. Or as always, email me, call me, do not hesitate for a moment. Even when I'm gone next week at my conferences, I will still be available and I'm more than willing during this time period to talk with you outside of work hours as well. The rigs are my life for the next few months, and I am fine with that. As long as you are fine with that, I will find the time to meet with you. Thanks. Excellent. Well, if there are any other questions, please send them to me offline. Otherwise, thank you very much for your time, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing your proposals. Thanks. Have a great day.